Hi everyone, welcome. This is HUM310, the American musical. This is a very unusual class, and we've had quite a time tracing how our American musicals tell a lot about our American society. So this is a course that looks at how our shows reflect who we are. So welcome, thank you for joining us. Look forward to hearing from you today. Maybe some of our students will log in and send some questions to us because we are live and online here at Distance Learning. And today we have a wonderful program. We're going to look at the 1960s. And believe me, this is where the American musical changes in a very interesting way. And we're going to look at a very highly representative musical from that time, Cabaret, in our second half. So hope you'll join us and express your interest and admiration for some of the unique musicals that came out of these turbulent years. Just a note for some of our students. Oh, there's that toll-free number. Feel free to join us today. 1-800-339-1193. Anywhere in North America, you can call us and post a question or respond to our focus question. There also is a way to contact us. AskDHTV@gmail.com. Feel free to type in a response, and I will see them here on the monitor so we can have something of a discussion. But yes, it's a theater medium, and that tends to develop dialogue with audiences, so we'd love to hear from you today. Some of the announcements, we only have, after this broadcast, 2 weeks left. I told you it was going to be short and sweet. And then next week we'll go off to the 70s and 80s, and in the final broadcast we'll look at what happens in the 90s and some of the musicals now. So we're traveling by the light of speed here, by light speed here. But we're going to see an interesting change in musicals now that we are in the 1960s. We're going to separate the world of what was known as your parents' music, if you were a Rodgers and Hammerstein aficionado. And now we're going into an age where rock and roll, as well as some other developments in the 1960s, are going to create some interesting changes. So it's a very unique time. And that is why our focus question today is, what impact did the 60s have on the musical? So a good way for you to interact with us today is to respond to this question. What impact did the 60s have on the musical? You may even remember a musical that somehow reflected some of the amazing changes that went on there. And our students who are busy looking for a final project, and by that I mean a paper that they can write about, a musical, please look at the guidelines to see how you can make the paper a thesis-based piece of writing, the thesis being, how does this musical that I've selected reflect America? And the students in this class, just as they recently did with a fan video, are going to make taped speeches and send them up to YouTube so we'll be able to see them on the final broadcast. I don't know if students want to hear about that, but that's where we're heading as we are turning the final run of the American musical in HUM 310. Okay, so yeah, there's our focus question. Look forward to hearing from you today. But yeah, let's see how musicals are now going to change once we come into the civil rights movement. We have rock and roll. We have Vietnam to deal with. And just to give you a little highlight of how the American musical is going to change from what we saw with Rodgers and Hammerstein. We just talked about South Pacific and Carousel, and we had started with looking at Showboat and My Fair Lady. Notice how things are going to change when you look at this clip, and this is Let the Sun Shine In from Hair.
The dawning of the
How wonderful. Where did The Sound of Music go? Where did all those great musicals go? Look at just the cast who is singing there in Hair. The Age of Aquarius announces a new age for sure, just as the following number, Let the Sun Shine In, was an attempt to be more open in the way that we live our lives, because conservative forces had pretty much settled into America and created the same Cold War that maybe some of you are seeing on that wonderful CNN sequence that has been offered lately on the 60s to show the impact that such things as the Cuban Missile Crisis caused people to fear a nuclear disaster that was not going to just blow out one city, but possibly the whole world. So this was a reaction to what was happening. How did we get here? Let's take a brief look at what started with the Civil Rights Movement. 1954, the Brown versus Board of Education decision legally ends segregation, which, amazingly enough, was legal in our country for over 58 years, that blacks had to have education in a different place than whites. Bathrooms as well. Places on the bus as well. In fact, the Montgomery bus boycott comes in 1955, followed by the confrontation in Little Rock. Many situations like the sit-in at Woolworths in North Carolina establishes nonviolence as a way to combat the racism that was quite strong in America. We have Freedom Riders, 1960s, coming down to the South to sign up voters and being physically, violently attacked and killed. So we have incidents that are just horrendous. Violence when Meredith tried to enroll at University of Mississippi. We have George Wallace standing in front of the University of Alabama trying to keep it segregated. The attacks on Martin Luther King's protesters in Birmingham. Remember, 1963, the I Have a Dream speech, which a wonderful, wonderful moment, was followed in just a few months with the Birmingham church bombing that killed four young girls. So the reason why the musical changed was obvious. The civil rights movement demanded a different response. And of course, by the time we get to the late 60s, there are riots in Watts, Detroit. By the end of the 60s, 100 cities are seeing civil rights disturbances. So this impact is going to be strong. Your author, Jones, talks about who wants to write a musical when we have such drama in the streets due to the civil rights movement? So your writers are not going to be wanting to sing at this time. So the black musical disappears. However, it's interesting to note how many black authors write very aggressively angry plays. Amira Baraka writes things like The Dutchman, which is a horrifying play. It takes place on a subway and features this white woman who's like a mythological Jim Crow character who throws black men off of the subway, killing them with a number of other white supremacists there. So very angry plays reacting against what was going on. Ed Bullins, Douglas Turner Ward, Lonnie Elder. These are great names who are writing for black communities about black issues. They didn't care if white audiences came to see it. So it was quite an interesting time, but not for the black musical. Also realize too that the civil rights movement helped motivate other great movements as well. So all those suburban kids in the 1950s become the counterculture of the 1960s, and we start seeing hippies. We start seeing students taking over buildings at Berkeley to kind of protest the lack of free speech. So a whole nationwide movement, and of course, Vietnam becomes the major issue that motivates many of these protest movements. In 1965, our first Vietnam protest drew 15,000 to Washington. By the time we get to 1969, there's 250,000 people coming to protest in Washington, what was happening in Vietnam. The women's movement, the war on poverty, which Lyndon Baines Johnson was very powerful in developing. This was a time when issues were very current in the news every night, so it makes total sense that musicals would respond to them. However, amazingly enough, America wanted to keep the 1950s. Remember we talked about utopia and kind of an isolationism. That went on for quite a while into the 60s until perhaps the Kennedy assassination was the moment that really changed it. So we get musicals like Carnival, which was a very lighthearted, Robert Merrill wrote that in 1961, featuring songs like Love Makes the World Go Round, Love Makes the World Go Round. I mean, these very lighthearted 50s style songs and musicals that are not really representing what's going on in America. The British actually get into the act and bring Oliver here. Lionel Bart had written a number of musicals, but he decided to take a Charles Dickens story and create some of the most charming orphans you've ever seen. Oliver is a wonderful musical, not to put it down, but it certainly was not a protest against poverty. It was a sympathetic look at a historical past. I think this clip from Oliver will give you the idea of how, in a way, it was almost a utopia image of a former time. Dickens was writing about the 1830s, 1840s, but in a way we could kind of embrace it in a sympathetic way in America. So this is a little clip from Oliver, 1960.
Please, sir, I want some more.
What?
Please, sir, I want some more.
More? That's it! Snatch him! Hold him! Skirt him! Pounce him! Pounce him! Pick him up and bounce him!
You named him so yourself.
So that's who he is. Oliver, Oliver, never before has a boy wanted more. Oliver, Oliver, won't ask for more when he knows what's in store. There's a dark, thin, winding stairway without any banister, which will throw him down.
And feed him a cockroach, you serve him a
Oliver,
Oliver,
what will he do when he's turned black and blue? He will rule the day. Somebody name him Oliver.
Even though it's about thieves and kidnappers living in Victorian London, it's so lighthearted that it's charming. And it works very well. Wonderful, wonderful songs that Lionel Bart wrote. It's almost a reflection of, remember last week we talked about Camelot. Here's the British giving us a kind of former world. Obviously, in the case of Camelot, we're looking at King Arthur and his knights. And in fact, that show became associated with the Kennedy presidency. Jack Kennedy used to supposedly play songs from it at night, and Jacqueline Kennedy reflected on the irony of his loss, as well as what King Arthur was singing about when Guinevere leaves him and Camelot is no longer. So this look at a former time, the 50s style stayed with us. It's very interesting in the 1960s. How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying was a wonderful musical, 1961. Frank Lesser, who gave us Guys and Dolls, and Bob Fosse. Who else but Bob Fosse could choreograph a number? This is a wonderful image. Look at the physical movements there of the cast. But it's basically a story of a nice guy and his rise to, you know, become a leader in the business world. But it's a very satirical look at the American corporate world. Wins a Pulitzer Prize, though, and very enjoyable. No Strings, another wonderful musical. Interesting that Richard Rodgers, now that Hammerstein has passed away, Rodgers writes both the music and the lyrics to this song, to this musical, working with Samuel Taylor. And oddly enough, it's about an interracial couple. Diane Carroll and Richard Kiley, two wonderful talents, play this couple, and there's hardly ever a mention about their interracial relationship. It's just kind of glossed over. America evidently wasn't ready to really deal with it out front. Wonderful songs, the sweetest sound in all the world is waiting there for me. Wonderful tune that many other singers would sing. So very similar to Carnival in a way. These are lighthearted tunes that are very catchy. It's the idea with a good musical. And Stephen Sondheim finally can get into the act. He does A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum in 1963, and he writes not only the lyrics, as he did in West Side Story, but he writes the music. So this is Sondheim's big first chance. It's based on a Roman play. Plautus wrote these silly comedies. In fact, Shakespeare's Comedy of Error is based on the Menechmi that Plautus wrote, and it's also the same idea. And you see some of the scenes there with Zero Mustel. I mean, it's very silly, humorous, farcical kind of work. But great songs like Comedy Tonight made it very engaging. And again, looking at Roman times was part of what made the audiences come. And there's a scene from the original Producers, the film of the Producers, Zero Mustel in all his glory. Perhaps one of the best representations of how America still held on to the 50s musical is Bye Bye Birdie, 1960. We showed a clip, remember, in the very first broadcast here, and it's got so many great songs like Got a Lot of Living to Do. Perfect example of 50s style music in the 60s. Blue skies are gonna clear, gray skies are gonna clear up, put on a happy face. I forget the lyrics. Put on a happy face and send sunshine all over the place. By 1969, people were not going to be having a happy face. Oddly enough, Bye Bye Birdie brought us to a wonderful time when we could have Conrad Birdie representing Elvis Presley having to go into the army, and he's going to give a final kiss to this girl who is selected. There's, you see Anne Margaret playing Kim McAfee with Bobby Rydell. Wonderful show, I mean, so entertaining. And Gower Champion did such great choreography on the Telephone Hour, a very unique sequence in that show. But my point is, the world around them was going wild. We're dealing with the Berlin Wall going up, we're dealing with the Kennedy assassination. And there's still this insistence that the Broadway musicals reflect a happier time. Well, things are going to change pretty severely. One of the things that helps it to change is the appearance of Jewish musicals. Remember now, black musicals disappear, but all of a sudden, even after decades of Jewish composers writing for the American musical, now we start seeing Jewish subjects on stage as we had never seen before. And a lot of it was the impact of things like the Holocaust, now that we had found out about it after World War II, and the founding of the State of Israel, as well as some Hollywood films like The Ten Commandments and The Robe. So it was now something people were curious about. So they went to see Jerry Herman's Milk and Honey in 1961. They went to see David Merrick's production of I Can Get It For You Wholesale that featured the very young Barbara Streisand, her first role on Broadway. But of course, one of the unique sights of seeing Barbara Streisand is in Funny Girl. Funny Girl took the storyline of a famous heroine. We had talked about Fanny Brice because she, like Burt Williams, was the MC for Lorenz Ziegfeld back in the 20s and 30s. She had become a famous radio figure as well. So here's this famous Ziegfeld star, and basically you look at her rise from her Jewish neighborhood to love and fame as well. So Jewish life was on stage, New York Jewish life, and did very, very well with great songs, people, wonderful ballad that Barbara Streisand was just phenomenal at Don't Rain on My Parade, Don't Tell Me Not to Fly, I Simply Got to. If someone has a spill, it's me, I'm not you. Don't tell me I'm allowed to, you're not allowed to rain on my parade. So wonderful, wonderful songs, especially sung by Streisand. But the real pivotal musical for the Jewish musicals is obviously Fiddler on the Roof. And this was something of a surprise because a lot of the producers felt that, are people going to really take to scenes of East European Jews living in a small town? It's such a remote location. What will people take to this? Well, it becomes a major crossover hit. 3,000 some performances. I mean, in the 60s, we have 10 shows that go over 1,000 performances. None like Fiddler, though, that goes over 3,000. So this all of a sudden became a huge hit, primarily because it was about Tevye, or Zero Mostel again, and how he tried to deal with his daughters changing from the tradition that they had been brought up with. It became about intergenerational conflict, which was a 60s theme for most every family in America. So it was an interesting crossover. I have an interesting clip here that tells a little bit more about Fiddler on the Roof. And since it was so pivotal, so many shows would come as a result of Fiddler. It became big business now, the Broadway musical. So if you get a hit, you should repeat it with, after Fiddler we get Let's Sing Yiddish, Hello Solly, 1967, Sing Israel Sing, Light, Lively, and Yiddish, all of these musicals that aim to kind of repeat the formula. And that is something we'll see in the Broadway musical forever, still with us today. But let's look at a little clip from the original. So this is Fiddler on the Roof.
1964, which broke the record for the longest running show in Broadway history, was perhaps the most unlikely. Fiddler on the Roof.
If I were a rich man, all day long I'd bump. If I were a wealthy man, I wouldn't have to work hard. If I were a pretty, pretty rich, yes, a diddle, 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 man.
Based on Sholem Aleichem's short stories depicting a Jewish village in 1905 Russia, Fiddler was the last original work Jerome Robbins created for Broadway.
The key to making Fiddler work was Jerome Robbins' idea. I can't tell you how many meetings we had where he said, "What is this story about?" And one of us said, "It's about the changing of a way of life, of a set of traditions." Robbins got very excited and he said, "Well, if it's about tradition, then we have to have an opening number which tells the audience what some of these traditions are."
Tradition! Tradition!
Tradition. It's this. It's that. It's everyone standing in a row, holding hands. This is the way we live. This is what we believe in. And those traditions are going to be broken. Fiddler is about that.
I remember the day that I registered to college, Fiddler on the Roof opened on Broadway. We didn't realize it at the time. It was the sunset of the old style Broadway musical that came in with Rodgers and Hammerstein. The opening number, Tradition, was actually about the closing of an era of the Broadway musical. The curtain rose on Fiddler, but it came down on that kind of show.
It was really the advent of rock and roll that pushed Broadway musical out of the mainstream of American culture, because up until then, Broadway music had been the top 40, the top 10 hit parade music of the country, and that started to change. And by the late 1960s, it was a done deal.
Hello, Daddy. This is Nurse Daddy.
In May 1964, Louis Armstrong's rendition of Hello, Dolly spent a week at the top of the charts, breaking the Beatles' run of three straight months.
You keep blowing, still growing, you still going strong.
It was one of the last times in the 20th century that Broadway had a number one hit song.
Well, the culture is definitely shifting, but Broadway, it was basically trying to ignore the 60s. The typical musical of the height of the Vietnam War could be something like How Now, Dow Jones, you know, or George M. Shows that are promises that have absolutely nothing to do with the main culture of the moment.
Don't you ever go away.
It was really the consummation of Broadway musical falling out of sync with pop culture.
Wonderful point that they're making, that the curtain goes up on Fiddler, but it comes down in a way on the traditional Rodgers and Hammerstein musical. Something new was happening. And in that video, they have the Beatles arrive immediately, 1964. Things were going to change for the American musical thanks to rock and roll, as well as some other issues. And it's great that they represented Hello, Dolly, which not necessarily that it's a Jewish musical, but Jerry Herman wrote the music. It was based on Thornton Wilder's The Matchmaker, which is actually a play from the 30s based on a trip to Chinatown, which was 1892 that gave us After the Ball. So going back to the historical roots. But yes, Hello, Dolly becomes a vehicle for Carol Channing, who started it off, and Ginger Rogers, Ethel Merman, Mary Martin. It's amazing how many people, Pearl Bailey with a full black cast. But those musicals were now starting to change, and a lot of it had to do with the issues that were around us. And playwrights began to start writing about what mattered. Viet Rock, for instance, 1966, was the first, it wasn't a Broadway show, but what happened was it represented a new way of taking on these issues. So you have actors creating the play based on improvisation. Joe Chaykin was a famous theater director, and his Open Theater helped evolve this. But it was Megan Terry who actually wrote it. It's the first rock musical in the United States, the first protest play against Vietnam, and the first time we're going to see actors leaving the stage to interact with the audience. Something was new in America. We were going to get a new way of even performing. In fact, we get what's called experimental theater, where now the ways of doing theater, the actual style of performance is going to change. These great theater directors like Peter Brook are reading the writings of Antonin Artaud from the 1920s and 30s, who say we should go back to ritual and get rid of these masterpieces like Shakespeare. Bertolt Brecht, they're reading about how Brecht is saying you shouldn't do a show unless it has some way of helping people improve the world, that there should be a social action involved in theater and not just entertainment anymore. So a lot of this is like philosophically based, but we're seeing shows that are done outside, happenings. Some of the very strangest of theater occurrences are happening. Theater of the absurd becomes very popular in America at the time. So a lot of unique changes, but it's the issues that become central. In fact, Bush Jones talks about how no longer are we watching plays about a central character, we're looking at a central issue here that's driving the play. And that is what the 60s will contribute and have a long-lasting effect in terms of the American musical. Great example is Man of La Mancha. Man of La Mancha was written by Dale Wasserstein, obviously a very interesting writer himself, sorry, Wasserman, who wrote One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, another play about giving people their voice. And this was, to some extent, very much the story of Don Quixote trying to help this woman, Alonso, as he envisions her as Dulcinea. And it's based on the Don Quixote novels by Cervantes 400 years ago, but Dale Wasserman made a very interesting libretto with music by Joe Darian and Mitch Lee that is very inspiring. In fact, this song here, we're going to see a clip here, becomes something of an anthem for many of the protest marchers in the 60s. They will sing The Impossible Dream as a way of saying, we need to change the world. We need to make this world a better place. Things are not great right now. So it was a protest, but it wasn't necessarily asking for anything specific, but it was uplifting in terms of the spirit that it offered. So this is a great example, and if you've never heard Brian Stokes Mitchell sing, listen to this man's voice. This was on a revival of the Man of La Mancha. The original featured Richard Kiley, but Stokes Mitchell is powerful. And watch how he interacts with the Dulcinea character in this. It's beautifully staged. So this is The Impossible Dream from Man of La Mancha.
As well.
Quest? What does that mean, quest?
It is the mission of each true knight. His duty, nay, his privilege, to dream the impossible dream.
Not at this pitch.
To fight the unbeatable foe. To bear with unbearable sorrow. To run where the brave dare not go. To right the unrightable wrong. To love pure and chaste from afar. To try when your arms are too weary to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star. No matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause. To be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I lay to my rest. And the world will be better for this. That one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. This is my
Sorry, I needed you to see all that. You know, George Pierce Baker said, why do we write plays? What's the reason for us going to the theater? And he answered, to move people. So I wanted you to see that whole thing because it's so powerful. And that's what, you know, we go through all of these musicals in terms of the history of them, but realize that within each one, there's such power in a single voice. And just his physical stance there was so unique. Yes, the Don Quixote story, it's something that has motivated people to have hope. And that's a lot of what the theater offers to people, isn't it? I want to mention to you that next year is the actual 400th anniversary of the two novels that Cervantes wrote in 1605 and 1615. And on campus here, we're actually doing a Quixote festival that will feature some of Man of La Mancha, a dance concert, and I'm actually directing a show by a contemporary playwright, Octavio Solis, called Don Quixote. It's basically the first novel, the story of the first novel. So we're celebrating this great anniversary. Also wanted to mention too, my producer just mentioned that the Tonys are tomorrow night. A lot of the clips that I've shown you in the broadcast are from Tony Award celebrations. In theater, we take down the set and put everything away after the last performance. It's not like a film where you have this thing you can always see. So some of the only footage we have of Broadway musicals are from the Tony Awards celebrations. Now, this goes back to the 1930s when Antoinette Perry, she was a producer, actress, thought that actors should be giving a little more kind of feedback on, and so the awards system was created for Broadway, unlike the Academy Awards for Hollywood. So tomorrow night you may want to see, but it's interesting how it has helped preserve footage of a lot of great numbers. I think in The Fiddler on the Roof, you also saw a section of a Tony Award presentation. So yeah, check the Tonys out tomorrow night. I also want to mention, just before we leave Fiddler on the Roof, a wonderful comment by Lawrence Gergovich on issue-driven musicals, because obviously this is very much at the beginning of them in the 60s. The issues-driven musicals of the 60s, mentioned by Jones in Chapter 6, was what I found most interesting in the readings in this week. Musicals such as 1776, Cabaret, Hair, and Man of La Mancha all seem to tackle issues, raise questions, and make one examine his or her own thoughts, values, beliefs, and understanding. That's excellent, Lawrence. That's exactly how the musical changed. Now, certainly Hammerstein was getting us to do that, but it never became so powerful as we'll see in the 60s. Sorry, I'm interrupting your comment. Although perhaps not in your face as some productions, the subversive nature and satirical approach of these productions seem to follow a time-honored approach by Molière, Voltaire, Dickens, and Orwell, to name a few. Thank you, Lawrence. I'm glad you're putting our 60s musical in that same category of great writers. But yes, issue-driven musicals, that's where we are, certainly with Man of La Mancha. And 2,300 performances. It was staggering, but shocking. But it certainly got to the heart of what people felt. Now, realize Broadway is still producing things like Sweet Charity, where you're getting to see Bob Fosse do the choreography with his wife, Gwen Verdon, and she's singing, Hey, Big Spender, spend a little time with me. So Broadway will always have that, but things are changing, and they will change with Cabaret, which we're going to look at in the second half today. Obviously, what John Kander and Fred Ebb write with the help of John Masterhoff, who writes the libretto, based on Christopher Isherwood's stories and John Van Druten's play from the 1950s. Now we are seeing a whole musical dedicated to make an analogous statement about life in America and whether or not the chance for what happened in fascist Germany in the 30s could happen here. So we'll look at that in the second half, but a strong concept musical, as we'll talk about. And perhaps the greatest of all the concept musicals was Hair. Hair, 1966, actually went to Broadway in 67, is a wonderful representation of the whole decade, if you will. Perhaps the apotheosis of all the issue-driven musicals, because now we don't have a plot that drives a musical. It's not like there's a central character and you just follow their story. Each scene is a different issue. So we'll have pollution. There's a musical number that deals with pollution. There's one that deals with civil rights. There's one that deals with race relations, one on Vietnam, one on patriotism. The organizing principle in the whole musical are the issues. The issues are at the center of everything. In fact, if there is a central character, as Joan says in the reading, it's the whole tribe, the cast of characters who are in the play. It's the ensemble. So it's very group-centered, although it's very much about individual rights. That is what people talk about when they refer to hair. Nudity, this is a later production. The original production, which I was lucky enough to see, the nudity was not in any way gross. It was just the idea of opening yourself up. It was much more of a spiritual connection in the original musical than seeing butts in front of you. But it certainly created controversy, as well as some of the issues that they took up, a kind of lament about what has happened in America. Many took as being unpatriotic, but many took as a way of saying, as we did with Impossible Dream and Man of La Mancha, let's do it better. Let's work on making this world a better place. And you have these great songs like we saw, Age of Aquarius and Let the Sun Shine, Let the Sun Shine In, songs you could easily sing. Galt McDermott was a rock and roll musician. So he wrote the music with wonderful songs like Easy to Be Hard, How Can People Be So Thoughtless, How Can People Be So Cruel, Easy to Be Hard. It's a wonderful, wonderful ballad. Songs like Age of Aquarius, which we saw, and Hair, the opening number, obviously. Well, anyway, I have a little clip here that I want to share with you that gives you a sense of why people were so shocked by Hair, because this scene takes on some of the interracial issues that were very central, as you saw in that opening clip. The cast had everything, except for age. There wasn't ageism yet. We had a very young cast. In fact, parents brought their kids from the suburbs to go and see Hair just to find out, what is it all you young people are trying to say? It became a way to learn about your own child. It became such an interesting intergenerational and interracial educational experience. So this is from the London production, but it is very much the same as the Broadway production. So this is Black Boys, White Boys from Hair.
But I went nearly crazy
I don't know how I can tell you how shocking that was to audiences when you see these white girls coming out and singing how delicious black boys are, and then the black girls come out and talk about the white. At that time, I mean, it was just irreverent. Not that shocking today, of course, but that's what Hair was attempting to do, was to open things up and make people, yes, get upset, because things were bad. And it was, as controversial as it was, Hair was not asking for us to go out and burn buildings or anything like that. It was almost a little passive in the way that it kind of pleased audiences and showed you what the issues were. It was almost a sense of reporting, perhaps. And we'll see how cabaret is different than that. Some interesting comments here. I have Brandon Voltz responding to our focus question. We were talking about how the issues of the 60s may have changed our musicals. And Brandon's going to comment on Hair. So yeah, feel free to join us and do what Brandon did, which is go online and be able to send us a response here. But Brandon basically is saying, I did my final paper on Hair, and I loved how it was a realistic characterization of the 1960s. It was even made with a communal approach, which was against the traditional approach to making musicals. Very good point there, Brandon, that it was, realize that you didn't have entrances and exits in Hair. People didn't like go off stage and then wait for when they were called out for their next number. Everybody was on stage the whole time, sometimes in the audience. There were songs that were sung with people walking over audience chairs. So you were always aware of the group. It was like you were invited to meet the tribe, which is how it's actually billed, a tribal rock opera. And that's the other aspect of Hair. Clive Barnes, famous New York Times reviewer, was complaining for years that we were still insisting that the Broadway musical follow the Rodgers and Hammerstein approach to music. And he felt that, when are we going to get rock and roll into it so that we can have the youth come out to our shows? Because there was almost a straight dividing line. As soon as Bill Haley started Rock Around the Clock in 54 or 55, the youth began listening to rock and roll, and they did not want to listen to Frank Sinatra, Judy Garland, Richard Rodgers anymore. So it was time for a change in the American musical, and Hair showed what it could be. And this, we didn't have a lot of shows that duplicated Hair right away, but it did make its statement. So yes, Brandon, and the idea of an ensemble, we'll see, for instance, next week, Stephen Sondheim writes a musical called Company. In other words, it's about a number of people on stage, and they are always on stage, so you're always seeing a group. Interesting how the 60s is often associated with group actions. I also want to comment, another thing that Hair contributed was some legal victories, and William Grievous made a wonderful comment here. I want to read some of what happened to Hair when it started to go on tour, and in Boston, in the Midwest, people were totally opposed to this. I can say quite honestly, I remember hearing the musical, hearing the record, the album, not downloaded from iTunes, and being shocked. And I was pretty, I was a theater person, so it's not like I was entirely conservative at that time. But interesting how William phrases this, too. I think you'll agree with me. Because of the controversy stirred up by the production's edgy content, Hair was met with resistance and challenged legally when it ventured off-Broadway to tour the country. The city of Boston tried to close the show based on criminal charges of obscenity. After a seesaw battle through the courts, the case finally ended up in the U.S. Supreme Court, ultimately ending with the Supreme Court upholding a lower court's decision granting Hair injunctive relief from a criminal prosecution, a victory for free speech, protection of artistic expression. Similarly, in Tennessee, Hair ended up in a court again after a municipally owned theater refused the production use of its facilities. Again, the legal battle made its way through the courts, ending up in the U.S. Supreme Court. As with Hair's last visit to the U.S. Supreme Court, the production was once again victorious, with the court finding that it was unconstitutional to exercise prior censorship, not allowing a production to first perform prior to making a determination on content. And that also had happened in Boston as well. As Jones points out, it was the anti-establishment hair which scored two Supreme Court victories for the American theater. And in my opinion, William is saying, in my opinion, Hair exemplifies what an issue-driven musical with social relevance is capable of accomplishing. Thank you, William, for showing us the what Hair accomplished for freedom of expression, freedom for artists in America. So it, oddly enough, became quite a statement about America in the late 60s. So yeah, Hair, very unique musical. And it's interesting to see contemporary versions of it as that clip that we showed was reflective. Another interesting musical that Lawrence had mentioned was 1776. Now, this is a show that was about the signing of the Declaration of Independence during that hot July in Philadelphia. But Peter Stone, who was the librettist, did a lot of research on the actual founding fathers and helped to make them real human beings. So you got to learn a lot about John Adams and Jefferson and problems with their wives. It put a real face on America because of the way that it portrayed our founding fathers. It wasn't just kind of a stamp. So a true portrait of revolutionaries, and that was the unique thing about 1776. They're being presented at the end of the 60s, you would think something patriotic would just do so poorly, but it actually became an antidote for the troubles that were there in 1969 and to some extent presented what a lot of the youth was feeling at the time. So very interesting, 1776. Margie LaCosta wrote a nice discussion board posting, which I'd like to share with you too, on how 1776 really does represent the 60s. It took history out of the textbooks and turned it into real men with real concerns and real debates about severing ties to England and what the fate of the colonies would be. In a time of civil unrest and sometimes violent debate about human rights, it was not only a coincidentally well-timed dose of patriotism, but a look at how sometimes radical changes need to be made to better our society. That's brilliant, Margie, and that's exactly what the issue-driven musical was doing in the 60s, and perhaps why, other than maybe in the Depression, remember we had a sense of this as well with some of those satirical musicals, why it could only be the 60s that could generate this new approach to the American musical. So it's... We've come a number of years to see how each generation, each decade, seemed to offer something new in the development of the American musical. It did not stay the same, that's for sure. So thank you, Margie. Very, very interesting comment. And before we take our break, I do want to at least cover the return of the Black musical. Remember how there was just too much going on in the 60s, especially with the riots. But once we get to 1970, it's interesting that Ossie Davis and Ruby Dee, who had written a play, Pearly Victorious, in the early 60s, now move it to a musical. And this helps to give a new view of how to perhaps phrase or present the African-American situation. It's actually an attack on Southern redneck bigotry. So there is a protest being offered, but the music that Gary Geld did and Ossie Davis's wonderful dialogue allowed you to be entertained in a very unique way. Of course, Cleavon Little was there, a very young Melba Moore, so you had great entertainers. So it was a way of showing Black pride. This was the era of Black power and Black pride, so it presented a new approach, and we'll see how many Black musicals will take this new approach. But just to give you a little sense of Pearly and what it offered audiences, here's a little clip called I Got Love from Pearly with Melba Moore.
Love, I got love, I got love.
Louder than the power, going by the hour. I got love.
you find your foot like just starting to stamp as you were watching that? So this is now a new approach for black musicals. Now anger takes a backseat to racial pride. And we're going to see it in shows like Don't Bother Me, I Can't Cope, 1972, which was a review, but Vinette Carroll, Mickey Grant wrote this to entertain, but to touch on issues that were very relevant to African Americans. Perhaps the greatest statement of this new approach was The Wiz. The Wiz 1975 was a deconstruction, if you will, of The Wizard of Oz story. But Charlie Smalls wrote a wonderful score for this, and Jeffrey Holder was the director. Jeffrey Holder was a famous choreographer, a dancer himself. But there was a retreat now from issues of racism. It was more pride and joy rather than anger. And we'll see that, obviously, in this little clip. You're going to see the original Stephanie Mills doing the famous number, Ease On Down the Road. So this is from The Wiz. After The Wiz, after Pearlie, the black musical is not going to disappear anymore. In fact, next week we'll take a look at Dreamgirls and a number of musicals that keep the African-American musical very healthy throughout the rest of the 20th century and beyond. A wonderful comment that Jasmine Brehm made on our discussion board, and we'll finish with this before we take our break, because she kind of concludes it in a very interesting way. So thank you, Jasmine. But Jasmine says, by the second half of the 1960s, civil protest had pretty much been overtaken by angered protests and riots. Where in the beginning of the 60s, African Americans wanted to show their similarities to that of whites, they now wanted to celebrate their differences. We see this at the time as the rise of Black Power, the Black Panthers, and Black Separatism. In my mind, much like Hammerstein and his socially aware musicals, the more you introduce an idea to people, the more open-minded they become to it. So, by black writers finally being able to write more authentic plays with no stereotypes and embrace their culture and color, I think it helped pave the way for more civil rights, acceptance, and tolerance. By 1975, we see black musicals letting go of the anger, protests, and riots, and now embracing their culture, heritage, and music. It's really amazing to see, in my opinion, how much the musical theater at times impacted and helped push along American issues, people, and mood. I agree with you, Jasmine. I think the American musical has not just been a reflection of America, but has actually kind of provided perhaps a way of interacting, a way that we should perhaps see other people in a different light. So, of course, the power of going on stage or going on film or going on television is a very important political act as well as artistic. So thank you, Jasmine. Thanks for seeing that. Well, listen, we should take a little break here, but I want to come back and talk to you about one of the most issue-driven musicals of the 60s, and it had a strong impact on many, many producers, actors, directors, Cabaret. So I hope you'll join us after the break for Cabaret.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We'll be right back. Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Iron Chef 6!
Amazing.
This is good. I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love, love, love. Brother, love, that Mandarin sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the Literals.
We're passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and where to, what to find inside the gym.
My name is Alberto Mieriterán. I'm the Senior Vice President and General Manager of the Univision Los Angeles television stations. We have a beautiful partnership with Cal State Dominguez Hills and the Cal State University School System, in which we have partnered up to do what I consider, I'm a little biased, the best educational fair in the country. Fifth year of working with Cal State Dominguez Hills, and it's been absolutely a wonderful success story in the fact that every year it grows, it gets better. It's a huge resource to the community, to both the surrounding community in Carson and to the Latino community.
So it's really, really exciting.
exciting that we are trying to increase like the amount of students that go into college.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Alberto Mieriterán. I'm the Senior Vice President and General Manager of the Univision Los Angeles television stations. We have a beautiful partnership with Cal State Dominguez Hills and the Cal State University School System, in which we have partnered up to do what I consider, I'm a little biased, the best educational fair in the country. Fifth year of working with Cal State Dominguez Hills, and it's been absolutely a wonderful success story in the fact that every year it grows, it gets better. It's a huge resource to the community, to both the surrounding community in Carson and to the Latino community.
So it's really, really exciting that we are trying to increase like the amount of students that go into college.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi everyone, welcome back to HUM 310, the American musical. We're looking today at the impact of the 60s on the American musical, and right now we're going to look at a very pivotal show, Cabaret. Very unique concept musical, as it's sometimes called, although Hal Prince, the director of the show and the kind of inspiration behind it, didn't like that concept of calling it a concept musical, but it was. The actual cabaret in the play, in the musical, is kind of this limbo world that allows comments to be made about what's going on in the lives of Sally. Sally Bowles is the central character to some extent, but oddly enough, and in very issue-driven musicals like this one, your characters are not the center of it all, the issues are. And this is a perfect example, how Prince wanted to focus on the analogous situation using metaphors and analogies to basically ask, could it happen here? What happened in Nazi Germany? Could it happen in America? So that was the heart of the story, not so much the characters themselves. And let me just say that my students watched the film version that Bob Fosse made in 1972, and you can't get as different, the same musical in two different versions as that film, where Fosse focused more on the kind of sensual world of, and his dancing is wonderful. The choreography that Fosse does is fantastic with Liza Minnelli, just amazing. But the original 1966 stage musical is so different. Fosse didn't want to deal with a lot of the issues that drove Hal Prince's early version. So I want you to get a little look at this, because this clip here will show you some segments from the original. And I also am going to show some other clips from other productions to show you what the real stage play is like. And oddly enough, that's one of the things that I can't do in this class, is show you a lot of the original works that are done. So we often, for instance, with Showboat, I showed you the 1936 film that was made after the 1927 stage version. But you're getting pretty much the main idea. So here's a little clip that'll show you a little bit of what Hal Prince was after in creating Cabaret.
By 1966, protests and demonstrations were becoming an unavoidable presence across America. Hal Prince, now directing shows, was inspired by the civil rights struggle as he prepared a new work with music and lyrics by John Kander and Fred Ebb.
It was very stormy in our country when I started to work on Cabaret. And I brought in a photograph from Life magazine, a two-page spread of a bunch of Aryan Nazi boys snarling at the camera. And of course, it was in our country, and it was them snarling at some poor little black girl. So I used that to support the contention that wherever human beings are, terrible things potentially can happen.
Cabaret was an adaptation of the Berlin stories of Christopher Isherwood and a play based on them. The show depicted the debauchery of Berlin between the wars and the Nazi rise to power, presented by a master of ceremonies at the Kit Kat Club.
I was in the army in 1949 in Germany. I went to a little nightclub called Maxim's, which was in the cellar of a bombed out church. And there, a very diminutive MC came out with lipstick on his mouth and eyelashes and rouge to hide how really old he was.
Willkommen, bienvenue, welcome. Fremde, étranger, stranger. Glücklich zu sehen, just wie enchanté. Happy to see you, bleibe reste stay.
Joel Grey, made up in a way that even if you knew what he looked like, he'd be unrecognizable, comes out and starts singing a song that we all know now is Willkommen. But my friend Sarah Fischko and I looked at each other and said, is this show in German? We didn't know what it was. It was very out there. And it had all this sort of androgynous sexuality. It was mind-blowing. And the audience was baffled. It had a stronger effect on me than Fiddler 2 years earlier had, or Hello Dolly. You felt you were seeing something completely different.
Cabaret, I would say, pushed the envelope of what people were seeing in the Broadway musical. Most people thought it was a terrible idea, a musical about Nazi Germany, but Hal and John and Fred and Joe Masteroff had this very dark vision, and they found a framework in terms of the cabaret songs in which the musical numbers commented on the action.
Boris Aronson did the original set. Nobody's ever been greater designer than Boris Aronson. There were two musicals on stage. One took place in real rooms and one took place in limbo. And in limbo were these numbers which indirectly commented on the real book upstage. Somewhere in the middle of the second act, Sally Bowles leaves the real world, walks through a mylar curtain into the unreal limbo world and sings Cabaret.
What good is sitting alone in your room? Come hear the music play. Life is a cabaret, old chum.
At the end of that song, she goes and gets an abortion. What she's found out at the beginning of the song is that she's pregnant. What she decides at the end of the song is that she doesn't want to have the baby.
Right this way, your table.
That's a pretty powerful material for a Broadway musical comedy.
Long day, life is a cabaret, old chum. I'm me, a cabaret, old chum. And I love a cabaret.
Pretty powerful. Those of the students who saw the film version, you know that Liza Minnelli got the abortion before she went and sang the song at the end there of Cabaret. So there's a clear indication in the Jill Hayworth version that she's singing this song about let's just party on and act like nothing is wrong here in Nazi Germany, 1930s. And she actually goes and gets the abortion afterwards. It helps her to decide that she's not going to stay with Cliff. Cliff is the writer who has come to Germany to hopefully inspire his writing. He's in the stage play, an English writer, an American writer. In the version that you saw in the film, they have a wonderful Michael York in that version, and he's English. In fact, they changed Sally Bowles from being an English cabaret club singer from the original into an American. So Fosse changed things around quite a lot. Before we get fully into Cabaret, I do want to mention a wonderful comment that was made by one of our students, Linda Holmes, on the difference between Cabaret and Hair. And I do think that it's very well-founded what she promotes here. Cabaret is dark and looks at the world through an ugly prism. In fact, you had that wonderful mention that Joel Grey talks about, how Prince had this very dark image. And Boris Aronson, who did the sets, which were very unique, but not totally entertaining, it created a kind of grim world of the 1920s in Germany. In fact, Boris Aronson, in the original stage version, has a mirror upstage that reflects the audience. You in the audience are seeing yourself. What better way to make a show relevant by putting your audience on stage with them? You saw in that little clip, too, that it was used in the film, the opening in the film. Bob Fosse has Joel Grey come out. But I the point of what Linda was saying about an ugly prism, it's a great way to characterize Boris Aronson's approach as the scene designer. Hair, the musical Hair, deals with real-world problems, but is so bright and idealistic that it's naive. Ironically, each of these two plays warns the audience about the same core issues, but Cabaret tells the audience that to be passive and to ignore them is compliance with evil. Hair tells the audience to tune in and drop out, make love, and the problems of the world will cease to exist. I found Hair's underlying message to be essentially the polar opposite of Cabaret. That's great, Linda. Cabaret is a kind of unsettling show. Richard Watts, who's writing for the New York Times, writes that it upsets you while at the same time it gives you theatrical satisfaction. It's a fun show to watch, but at the same time you're disturbed by it. And part of what is disturbing is that the basic premise of the play, the musical, is saying, don't put your head in the sand as Sally Bowles does. Our author Jones actually talks about her being an ostrich. She's just gonna go on singing in the cabaret as if nothing happened in Nazi Germany. A number of other characters do the same thing. Herr Schultz, in the original stage version, not the movie, Herr Schultz is this Jewish fruit dealer, seller, and he has a love relationship with Herr Schneider, who owns the boarding house that he is living in with Sally Bowles as well as Cliff. But she recognizes that taking up with a Jewish man with the Nazi rise to power is not a good idea. So Herr Schneider breaks off the marriage. She's perhaps the only realistic one. Well, Cliff decides to leave. So the way that all the four main characters in the stage play deal with the Nazi rise is very much at the heart of the show. But for us in the audience, in that mirror, we're being asked, are you just going to have your head in the sand and just let things happen? Hopefully that, you know, things are going to go the way that Herr Schultz says, oh, I'm sure that they're going to learn that the Jews are good people and they're not going to hurt them. So Cabaret, and I agree with you, Linda, is asking us to do something. It's asking us to have a social awareness that is active, whereas Herr is, in a way, a little passive in its approach. So very good analysis. I enjoyed that. All right, well, let's look at another clip here. And I do want to ask you, who is this MC character? That's a focus question. If I have any students out there watching, I'd be curious to know who you think the Joel Grey character is, the master of ceremonies, the MC. What or who does the master of ceremonies in Cabaret represent? That'll be our focus question for while we're talking about the musical. In fact, let's show that little clip from the original Will Coleman from the 1967 Tonys clip, and we'll be able to see Joel Grey do this movement again. So this is from that opening number called Willkommen in Cabaret. Strange-looking character. Hal Prince, in that clip that we saw earlier, was describing him. He's a little older than young, and he kind of is putting makeup on that's almost kind of clownish, clown makeup. He's obviously very effervescent in his energy, but at the same time, there's something disturbing about his character. I don't know if any of our students out there have a take on that. I'd be curious to know what you think the MC represents in Cabaret. So anyway, the storyline, obviously, Cliff comes to try to motivate his writing, and he gets Ernst Ludwig, who is not in the film, but sets him up in the boarding house there. And as it turns out, the MC at the Cabaret Club introduces Sally Bowles, who's now going to sing an important number. In the film version, we have Fosse, who wrote this wonderful sequence for her, for Liza Minnelli, Mein Herr. That's not in the original, although whenever Cabaret is done, as we did 2 years ago, Mein Herr is often put in, and it's a great moment for, especially for Liza Minnelli and for Fosse's great choreography. But what I want to show you now, and see if you can recognize who is the Sally Bowles here. This is from the London production that was done the year after, but this is Don't Tell Mama, which was the original song that was written to introduce Sally Bowles at the cabaret club. It's the first time Cliff actually sees her. So what does this say about Sally Bowles if this is her opening number? Okay, so this is Don't Tell Mama from Cabaret.
Ladies and gentlemen, and now the Kit Kat Club is proud to present the toast of Mayfair, Fräulein Sally Bowles!
Mama thinks I'm living in a convent. A secluded little convent in the southern part of France. Mama doesn't even have an inkling that I'm working in a nightclub in a pair of lacy pants. So, please, sir, if you run into Mama, don't reveal my indiscretion. Give a working girl a chance. Hush up, don't tell Mama. Shush up, don't tell Mama. Don't tell Mama. Whatever you do, if you had a secret, you bet I could keep it. I would never tell on you. I'm breaking every promise that I gave her. So won't you kindly do a girl a great big favor? And please, my sweet potato, keep this from the mater. Though my dance is not against the law, you can tell my papa that's all right, 'cause he comes in here every night. But don't tell Mama what you saw.
Mama sings a monitor of Europe, pays a couple of my school chums and a lady chaperone. Mama doesn't even have an inkling that I left them all in Antwerp and I'm touring on my own.
Just leave well enough alone.
Hush up,
don't tell Mama.
Shush up,
don't tell Mama.
Don't tell Mama, whatever you do.
If you had a secret, you bet I could keep it.
I would never tell on you.
I hope you also see the difference between watching a stage version, and that was obviously a film taken from a stage production, and what you would see in the Fosse film when you have a lot of editing and close-ups while they're singing, whereas here you can't see that. But I hope you have an appreciation for seeing the stage version and seeing how the Kit Kat Club was a much different statement in what Hal Prince and obviously the London version did than what we saw in Fosse's version. So a lot of the differences between the film and the stage version are very strong. In fact, I have a student who went into such depth on it. I want to share this with you. It's because it's written very well, too. But this is Lisa Benning, and she wrote on how the film and the stage version of Cabaret are so opposite. I watched Cabaret before doing the reading. I hadn't seen it before, and I loved it. My mom informed me that Liza Minnelli was Judy Garland's daughter. Yes, that's right. I should have made you all aware of that. I was amazed that I've gone all these years and didn't know that. After doing the reading, I decided that the movie lost some of the messages that Prince had put into the stage production. The movie focused more time on the relationship between Sally and Cliff, Brian, in the film, right? They changed the characters' names as well. Good, Lisa. And the rich guy and their awkward love triangle. And that is true. The film segued into something entirely different and brought those that triad relationship as the whole center of the film, as well as bringing Marissa Berenson, a totally new character, into it. So Fosse loved more of a kind of glossy show, and obviously his choreography was at the center of it as well. Sorry, I'm ignoring Lisa's comment here. It focuses more energy on Sally's greediness and lack of morals than it does on what is going on in Nazi Germany than the stage production did, at least based on my understanding of it, based on Jones's summary of it. The movie also changes the second love story of the two Jewish to two Jewish people, though one is in the closet in the beginning, the man, instead of one Jewish person and one non-Jewish person. In the play, the non-Jew chooses not to be with her Jewish lover for fear of the implications, which had more impact, in my opinion, on the seriousness of what was going on in Germany at the time. Very good. What happened in the relationship was a reflection on the politics of the time. Additionally, I didn't get the sense from the movie that Cliff felt passionately about what was happening in Germany as he did in the stage production. He seemed more concerned about who Sally was sleeping with and his career back in England. Nazi Germany, in my opinion, just felt like a background setting for where the story in the film happens. So while I really liked the film, I was somewhat disappointed to find that some of the more important messages got lost in the translation from stage to film. Lisa, that's a wonderful comment. In fact, I have to tell you that on stage, it's an entirely different medium than on film. Film has to be entertaining, and it's very hard to deliver a political message in a film. But the stage is ideal for it. The stage, not only are the actors live, but you and the audience are live, and it is meant to be a sharing of ideas. It has always been. So it's funny how sometimes when you have a play or musical that has political messages, and then Hollywood makes a film out of it, a lot of times you lose that punch. So here I am asking you all to see the 72 film, because I just don't have a version of the original that I would love to have had to share with you. So very good comments on the distinctions between the film. And obviously, in this number, Don't Tell Mama, that you just saw Judi Dench do. I don't know if anybody recognized her, but that was a very young Judi Dench, Dame Judi Dench, long before she's done such great roles. She's played Queen Elizabeth and been in the James Bond films as well, but that was her singing and dancing in Don't Tell Mama. And notice how that identifies who Sally Bowles is, as different from the number that you saw in the film, Mein Herr, which, like Lisa says, really highlights the immorality of the Liza Minnelli version of Sally Bowles. Here's another example that will show you a distinction. What happens to Sally is she gets fired from the cabaret and has to go find a place to stay. And so that's what gets her to move in with Cliff or Brian in the film, whichever you're following here. Out of that kind of odd mix comes another number. Now we go back to that limbo world of the cabaret and we see two ladies. This is where you'll see Joel Grey dancing with the two women, And it's very well done. Obviously, great work by Fosse in terms of the choreography. Very inventive. They get under the sheet, and at times they kind of poke themselves out. So it's a wonderful number. And it helps to characterize the world of the decadence of the 1920s in Weimar Germany. But I want to show you a clip that just will give you a highlight of how different colleges have done this musical and have taken different views here. So I'll let you see the clip first, but this is from Penn State, and this is their version of Two Ladies from Cabaret. So you can see what Penn State is up to here. I hope you caught the idea there that one of the two ladies was actually a man. So a lot of theater is open to interpretation, and to some extent it fits Cabaret quite well, that casting choice. It was a reflection of a kind of wide open sexuality and morality at the time, which was also reflective of Cliff's feeling that something strange was happening in Weimar Germany, and it was not good. It was going to lead to destruction. It's always interesting to see different versions of musical numbers. But that pretty much expresses a lot of the world of the play, too. So Sally ends up rooming with Cliff and has a relationship with him. In fact, will become pregnant. And that's where we get to the whole section of her getting an abortion. But before that, it's interesting that in 1972, when Fosse made the film, they created a new number called Money. It was not in the original. And whenever Cabaret is done now, usually that number is included because it's just so wonderful. So, and truly what Fosse does, and Joel Grey and Liza Minnelli did a wonderful number dancing it. But Cabaret has come to change with the decades. And in the 1990s, Alan Cumming did the MC in a version that was, I'm going to show you a clip from it, so you'll see how different the money number is in this clip from what you may have remembered having seen the film with Joel Grey and Liza Minnelli doing such a wonderful sense of movement talking about money. And that, in the film, comes right after she meets this very rich man, Maximilian, who was added to the film. And that becomes the kind of triad that she has with Cliff and Max. Anyway, here is a different version, just as we saw from Penn State, but this is actually from another Broadway production, but features Alan Cumming as the MC from Cabaret.
There's more than one way to make money. Money makes the world go round, the world go round. dollars go round. Money makes dollars go round. It makes dollars go round. A mark, a yen, a buck, or a pound, a buck, or a pound, a buck, or a pound, is all that makes the world go round. That clinking, clanking sound can make the world go round.
Can you see what a vast difference that scene is from what you saw on the film version, where you saw Liza and Joel Grey so sensuously celebrating money as something that is a wonderful thing to have? In this version, now this was directed by Sam Mendes and it came to Broadway in the late 90s with Alan Cumming in it. The concept here is that money can totally destroy who we are in terms of our own morality, and that whole sequence when he's giving the girls the money and hitting them, and I mean, that is a major advance from what we saw in the Fosse film. But to some extent, it is consistent with the whole philosophy of what Hal Prince was attempting to show, what was happening to our culture at the time. So it has stayed a concept musical, and even though times have changed, those times are reflected through these new concepts, in especially the Sam Mendes version. In fact, I think the final version, the final moment in Sam Mendes' production with Alan Cummings, as the MC, he takes off his uniform, and underneath he has a Jewish prisoner's uniform. So the statement about the Holocaust is even stronger in that version. It's interesting, I have Ganesh here who's responding to our question about who is this guy? Who is the MC in Cabaret? Thank you, Ganesh, for responding to our question. Ganesh says, since the cabaret represents the proverbial sand in which the people are burying their heads, very nice, Ganesh, because that does refer especially to Sally. Jones in the book says that Sally is an ostrich. She simply hides from what's going on around her, doesn't even see it, is in total denial. And that was so true in the 60s. Even though you see all these images of protests going on, many people did not know what to feel about Vietnam. They wanted to support our troops naturally, but at the same time, protecting democracy in Southeast Asia and that whole domino theory that as soon as Vietnam falls, then everything else is going to go communist. It had all to do with Cold War and anxieties. So that dilemma was very, very strong. So, sorry, Ganesh, but the proverbial sand is a great phrase that you're using there. I think the master of ceremonies represents all the forces in society that try to distract people from issues. Very, very interesting comment. Forces that encourage a relaxed attitude about life and moral values. All the forces against people having an awareness and an informed view on societal happenings. I think that's great, Ganesh, because he, our MC, to some extent represents why Sally is so happy to just be singing cabaret, life is a cabaret, old chum, and literally forget about the issues. That's a great take. And Ganesh goes on, in some ways, this makes the master of ceremonies really the forces of evil. Love it. Trying to keep the people asleep and passive while evil doings are running rampant into the world. He is dressed up in such a whimsical manner in a feeble attempt to hide, feeble attempt to hide his true character, which we only see glimpses of occasionally through the distorted glass. Very good. You even integrated the setting in that, Ganesh. And Ganesh finishes his comment here saying, very creepy. But Ganesh, you actually have isolated how attractive and entertaining, like Richard Watts said, you know, it's theatrically interesting, especially with Joel Grey doing all these wonderful numbers. And in the musical, in the film musical, his choreography with Bob Fosse was fascinating. So it's entertaining, but at the same time, it is deceitful. It's keeping us from having our social awareness connected to what we really should be focusing on. So I love how you say, to some extent, he's an evil character. He's getting us to hide from the facts. Very interesting deception. And his makeup and his whole look is very consistent with that. So great comment, Ganesh. Interesting, the version we just saw of Alan Cummings, though, there was a much rougher statement being made in his choreography and his makeup as well. So what happens then is in the play, Fräulein Schneider has her an engagement party with Herr Schultz, and then it is brought out that he's Jewish, and that causes her to back off from the marriage. And the end of the first act in the stage play ends with the song, this beautiful song, Tomorrow Belongs to Me, but sung by Nazis. It has a very creepy, would you say, connotation as well. The second act features a very unique performance, and I think we have the actual original version here from the film. If You Could See Her Through My Eyes, a very controversial scene where we're going to see the MC dancing with his chosen lover, and he'll explain why there's a problem. So this is If You Could See Her Through My Eyes from Cabaret.
Her swim my eyes, maybe.
I don't know if you recognize the MC in there, but that was Michael Hall, Michael C. Hall, who was famous as our Dexter. And this was actually a college production that he had done. But very controversial, because here he is dancing with an ape who is supposedly his girlfriend. And at the end of the scene, he adds, "If you could see her through my eyes, she wouldn't look Jewish at all." And they go into a to try to make a joke of it. But basically, the comment is that many people are really suffering with seeing Jewish people in such a different way. So it was a comment against the racist tendencies there in Germany. Of course, as Jones pointed out in our book, people in Boston didn't see it that way. The Jewish people who felt that it was saying that there was something ugly about Jewish people, and it caused them to actually change the lyrics. Masterhoff, Kander and Ebb actually changed it so that they wouldn't offend the Jewish people. But that's the kind of concept statement that happens all through Cabaret. And Brandon has another great comment about the MC. Thank you, Brandon. "I think the MC in Cabaret represents our evil conscience, like the devil on our shoulder. He seems to pop up throughout the film and announce things that reflect our more selfish desires." And there is a kind of hedonistic representation that the MC has. Obviously, he represents the whole cabaret world there, of leaving your troubles behind and just going and having not just something to drink, but you may have something to smoke. You may have a variety of pleasures. So very good, Brandon. I think he's dressed in that part as well. I just want to give you one little quick look at Jane Horrock's version of the final number. You've seen in the film Liza Minnelli sing "Life is a Cabaret, Old Chum." But notice the distinction here, and this is from the Sam Mendes version, and you can get the kind of roughness here and the kind of contradiction that's being offered when we see this strange contrasted version. So this features Jane Horrocks singing the final number, Cabaret, from the Sam Mendes production.
The Kit Kat Club is so happy to welcome back once again Fräulein Sally Bowles. Here! What good is sitting alone in your room? Come hear the music play. Life is a cabaret, old chum. Come to the cabaret. Put down the netting, the book and the broom. Time for a holiday. Life is a cabaret.
I think you can sense from the way she's singing it, which is totally different than the way Liza Minnelli sang it in the film, is that there's a kind of darker statement being made. And Mark Uehara said it beautifully in one of his discussion boards. Let me just read this to conclude our broadcast today. Mark says, "One must remember that life is not a cabaret, but one must be aware what is happening politically and socially and continually participate to prevent indignities and discrimination to individuals and groups in society." That's wonderful, Mark, and that's exactly why you see Sally Bowles, Jane Horrocks, in this version sing with a kind of roughness, because life is not a cabaret. It is it is something that we have to pay attention to in order to not discriminate against individuals and groups. So Mark, thank you for offering what is really the message behind Cabaret and what makes it such an issue-driven musical. Well, thank you for joining us for the 60s and Cabaret. Next week, we're going off to the fragmented musicals in the me decade of the 70s and 80s. Thanks for joining us on the American Musical.